I'm Katie Stratton with the I'm a training and development specialist, a program coordinator for Kids Now Plus. I am located within Department of Behavioral Health, DBHDID, in the Adult Substance Use Treatment and Recovery Services Branch. It's a really long new name for us. I've been in this position for about 2 years now, so I've taken over the position from Carol, if you guys remember Carol staying for a few years ago. So today we're going to discuss the impact of stigma and adverse childhood experiences on women, increase knowledge of women in addiction during pregnancy and treatment, and identify ways that we can help them. So we're going to start with this first slide, which I think is pretty powerful. The disease of addiction is strong, and when it feels threatened, it's especially...
Andy, I got a picture in here.
Estill County, can you mute your mic, please?
Sorry.
Tell him to open up his speaker.
You got your cover on.
I'm muted. We don't know.
Okay.
And Estill has their cover over their camera.
Yeah, Estill, we're not seeing a picture from you if you've got a cover on your camera.
We can't see a picture.
Okay.
We're working on it. I'm sorry.
Okay.
Go ahead, Katie.
The disease of addiction is strong, and when it feels threatened, it's especially deadly. I envision the disease as a voice screaming, "If I can't have you, then no one can," over and over and over and over, drowning out all other voices of hope and healing. So often when we think they just need to stop, this is what's going on in their head all the time. How is stigma defined? There are three different types of social stigma. Social stigma is the most common reason why women do not go into treatment. They do not continue doctor's appointments. They don't even get their children into doctor's appointments because of the fear of being judged by others. So enacted stigma refers to behaviors and perceptions by others towards a person who is seen as different, how people act towards them. This is how they say that people act when they go into the doctor's office. They treat me like I'm a drug addict. Perceived or felt stigma is what an individual thinks most people believe about them. In general, how the individual thinks society views them. So even though we may not treat them that way because they've been treated that way so many times in their life, they automatically believe this is how the whole population sees me. And self-stigma is the internalization of the public stigma. An extended definition describes as the product of internalization of shame, blame, hopelessness, guilt, fear, discrimination associated with their illness. So even though they may want to get help, they don't because they beat themselves up so bad about going to get treatment. How do individuals deal with stigma? They increase their drug or alcohol use. They show violence or aggression towards their children, their partner, or themselves. They self-harm, they will cut, they can take too many substances intentionally. They will discontinue service with a medical provider. They will refuse to seek out treatment or medical care, and they will often refuse to ask for help for herself or her children. How is stigma transmitted? There's five most common ways: stereotyping, historical associations, ignorance, abuse, and language. So stereotyping is when we group all of them together in one group, one heading, and saying that everyone that has this is the exact same. We make judgments on how people look. So if they're not well put together when they come into the doctor's office, and we know they're using substances, and we see more than one of those individuals, we automatically assume they're all experiencing the same thing. Historical associations often say those people are possessed. This is what we see in the movies. Ignorance is the lack of knowledge and the public awareness of how these disorders affect people. They make fun of mental illness and substance use, and they make assumptions without knowing the facts. We often hear people say, "She could quit if she really wanted to, and she must not really love that baby." And that's often when you have these mothers that have just delivered and they're their babies are addicted, as we see in the papers, which we'll talk more about that. Or they're on methadone or Suboxone. If she really loved them, she wouldn't be taking that medication. That is the ignorance around substance use being treated as an illness and not as a drug of choice. Persons, another one is abuse. When they get angered by people that have the illness, they can be physically abused. So if you live in the home with someone, a partner, mother, father, brother, sister, and that person is suffering with an addiction of some type or dependence on a substance, they may withhold food from them because they don't carry their weight. They're using their money to buy the substance of choice, so they won't feed them. That's a form of abuse. Or they could just physically abuse them because they think it's okay because they're under the influence frequently. Language is the one that people do not realize that we use the most. This is the words that we use that have unpleasant, it's unpleasant to them. We may call them an addict. We may call them an abuser, a user. They're dirty when they come in and have a positive screen. So we're using judgmental language when we talk to them. And so sometimes that all in itself will prevent them from coming and get the treatment that they need. The power of words to hurt or heal. Addict, abuser, junkie. It says that the preferred words is a person in active addiction, person with a substance misuse disorder, a person experiencing an alcohol drug problem, or patient. Because when we call someone an addict, an abuser, or a junkie, we are demeaning them and we're labeling them by their illness. We don't call someone a diabetic in a negative way. We call them a diabetic in a way in which they need to get treatment or help, that we can do that for them. User, person who misuses alcohol, drugs, or a person who engaged in risky use of substances is the preferred way to talk about someone we may have called a user in the past. A user is stigmatizing because it labels a person by his or her behavior. It's misleading because the term user has come to refer to one who's engaging in risky misuse behavior, but use alone is not necessarily problematic. Someone may drink alcohol socially, but we don't call them a user. Abuse, misuse, harmful use, inappropriate use, hazardous use, problem use, or risky use is preferred terms. When we say abuse, even though it is in or was in the DSM-4 and in ICD-10, it still is stigmatizing because, one, it negates the fact that addictive disorders are a medical condition, and it blames the illness solely on the individual with the illness, saying as though that they can prevent that from happening. You will begin to see abuse switched out for the word use. So instead of substance abuse disorder, it is now substance use disorder. Clean or dirty. This is how we often refer to a drug screen. Negative, positive, or substance-free is preferred terms because when we say someone has a clean screen or a dirty screen, people take that as in they are a dirty or filthy person. That if they tested on the screen as dirty, then no one's going to want to be around them because they're a filthy person. Habit or drug habit, we prefer substance use, misuse disorder, alcohol and drug disorder, alcohol and drug disease, or active addiction. When we say someone has a habit of using substances, we're calling the addictive disorders a habit, and that denies the medical nature of the condition and implies a resolution of the problem is simply a matter of willpower. They should be able to stop if they want to. Replacement or substitution therapy is treatment, medication-assisted treatment, medication, or a new term being used by SAMHSA is medication-assisted recovery. Because when an individual is on substance or Suboxone or methadone, that is a evidence-based practice, and it helps their brain stop craving the drug that they need and be able to think and focus on moving into treatment. Without their brain being able to stop on the focus of, I need to go get the drug I need now, they're not going to listen to anything we're saying because they're not focused on us. They're focused on using substances. It is also, we hear, replacing one drug with another. We do understand it right now in Eastern Kentucky, Suboxone is being abused. We understand that. However, that is an evidence-based practice of stopping. And when it is used in conjunction with therapy, supports, and treatment, it is effective. What can we do to help reduce stigma? And the biggest part is just have empathy. To try to understand and relate to someone else's feeling or is felt or what they are experiencing. It's one of the most powerful tools in reducing stigma. And when you imagine yourself in a situation and understand the emotions a person has felt during their experience, it's harder to cast judgment upon them. Because as we're getting ready to get into, a lot of the underlying reasons of the, for people using substances has to do with what they have experienced in their lifetime. Ways to increase your empathy: listen, don't interrupt, tune into nonverbal communication, practice the 93% rule, use people's names, be fully present when you're with people, smile at people, and take a personal interest in them. So the 93% rule is a study that's been done by UCLA.
Estelle?
Yes.
Your mic is open. Thank you.
The 93%.
Sorry about that. We've been having some technical difficulties and we had two remotes going at the same time. Sorry.
That's okay.
That's okay.
So the 93% rule is a study done by UCLA when communicating about feelings and attitudes. Only 7% of the total message someone sends out is through their words. The rest of that, 93%, is through voice and body language. So the easiest way for us to pick up on is someone being truthful with us, is someone accepting what we're telling them, is through voice and body language. So someone that comes into your office, if they're telling you their story about their struggles, asking for help, and we have a tone of voice that we give with them, even though we're saying all the right words, they're not going to believe anything that we're saying, because that tone of voice and the way that we look at them and make them feel with our body language is automatically going to shut the door. Increasing empathy helps everyone. 4 skills to increase the likelihood of malpractice suits and improve patient outcomes and greater patient compliance is: engage the patient, display empathy, educate the patient, and enlist the patient. This is where using ESPERT, screening, brief intervention, referral to treatment, is the best. It gives you all the tools that you need to be able to engage the patient and hear their story and getting the tools that you need to make a referral to treatment for them. Referral to treatment can be is something small as sending them to a specialist or getting them a referral for inpatient treatment. There's a great app. It's called the ESPERT app. It's now available on an Android device and an iPhone device or an Apple device. It gives you 3 screening tools that you need: the audit, the DAST, and the CRAFT. And those have no more than, I think, 5 questions on them. And it's a substance use screening tool. The only thing about it is you cannot print it. It stays within the device. But it walks you through the professional ESPERT method. So it gives you dialogue, and it gives you all the tools you need to carry on that conversation. You can even put in your client's answers. So if the client says, no, I'm not a heavy drinker, that's an option. You select that, and it'll move you on to the next question. So it will eventually, at the very end, will tell you whether or not they recommend a screening for treatment, a further screening, an assessment for treatment, or a referral. So when you, I know that the health departments are leaning more towards ESPERT, and there's some trainings that you guys have coming up. If you all have an EMR or an
we're working on that.
The EMR system, uh-huh. It will. You can put this app onto your Android tablet or your iPad tablet when those become available.
What's
ESPERT? S-B-I-R-T, screening, brief intervention, referral to treatment. We practiced, when it first came out, we practiced on each other in the office just to make sure it was accurate. And it gives you, so if you don't feel comfortable asking certain questions to your clients or your patients, it gives you the conversation written down for you. So even if you read it straight from your tablet, your phone, it's going to give you the tools that you need. So adverse childhood experiences is also trauma. So our healthy brain, this is what it looks like. Our cortex is the heaviest at the top, followed by limbic, midbrain, and brainstem. All of these refer to attachment, sexual behavior, emotional reactivity. This is what a normal brain looks like. So when you develop as an infant, as a child, and you have minimal high stress or trauma reactions, this is what a normal brain will look like as an adult. As trauma increases, high stress levels increase, your brain becomes imbalanced. When there's a disruption of the timing, intensity, quality, or quantity of normal development, the midbrain and the brainstem will become bigger than what a normal brain wants them to be. Often those are caused by the three levels of stress. So examples of positive stress would be meeting new people, learning new things, just your everyday problems on how you handle stress throughout the day. Tolerable stress, natural disaster, death, divorce, injury. And toxic stress is lack of support, extreme poverty, violence, abuse, depression, substance use, to name a few. And the more toxic stress that we experience as children, it directly relates to how our brain develops, how we experience things, and how we will manage things throughout our life. So the higher toxic stress is a direct relationship to trauma in our life. When situations of extreme stress are prolonged and unrelenting, the absence of supportive adults, that a child is affected by toxic stress. These situations can include poverty, as we mentioned, emotional abuse, chronic neglect, substance use, family violence. Without the support of a caring network of adults, toxic stress disrupts brain architecture and leads to stress management systems that respond at relatively lower thresholds, thereby increasing the risk of stress-related physical and mental illness. So as we experience those, we develop what is called adverse childhood experiences. This is a survey that was done by the Kaiser Health Plan. It had 1,700 participants, 80% were white, 75% had some college, 47% of them were male. The Kaiser Health Plan was a working plan, so you got this if you were employed, and you had to have health coverage. So they did this study that said if you experienced any of these characteristics in the first 18 years of your life, physical abuse, emotional abuse, sexual abuse, domestic violence, substance abuse in the home, mental illness in a parent, lost a parent due to separation or divorce, and a household member in jail. If you experience any of those, you developed an adverse childhood experience. 64% reported experiencing one or more of those categories. 37% reported experiencing two or more of those categories. And if you have one ACE score, there's an 87% chance you had more. So I know that I have at least one or two on here. So the difference between that is how we manage and the support systems we have in our life as we're growing up to determine where we will end up as adults. Childhood experiences versus adult alcoholism. So you can see there the brown box is zero. That the individuals had 0% or zero ACE scores. As you develop your ACE scores, 1, 2, 3, or 4, the chance of you becoming an adult with alcoholism concerns increases greatly. So if you had any of these, say you had physical abuse and domestic violence in your home, you had significant, you're there in the red, you had significant chances of developing alcoholism. A score, intravenous drug use. So 78% of IV drug use in women is attributed to ACE scores. So if they had four or more of those ACE scores, they were 78% chance that they will inject some type of a drug in their lifetime. So when we think about stigma and we think of these women that come into our office, we often don't see their ACE score. We don't see what they've experienced. We don't see that they grew up in a household of constant violence. We don't see that they are currently themselves in a relationship of violence, because that's usually not asked unless we see bruising or marks. Substance use in the home, mental illness in a parent, lost a parent due to separation or divorce, household member in jail. The family we grow up in matters. Drug use disorders co-occur in families. A major risk factor for drug initiation substance use disorders among women include chaotic, argumentative, blame-oriented, and violence. There's a family history of drug exposure. The ACE study demonstrated that the basic cause of addiction, smoking, alcoholism, drug use, food, sex concerns, is predominantly experience dependent during childhood, and it is not substance dependent. So the reason that they begin using is experience dependent. It's not because methamphetamine was laying on their table when they decided to use it. A male child with an ACE score of 6 has a 4,600% increase in the likelihood that he will become an IV drug user later in life. 78% of drug injection by women is directly attributed to the ACE scores. In all the studies that have been done, the ACE score, there's none that have the epidemiology connection to what we've experienced, unlike the ACE score. They just don't compare. Radiating effects of trauma. Psychological, anxiety, depression, suicide attempts or suicide, PTSD, poor self-esteem, blame and guilt, uncontrollable emotions. Social, isolation, withdrawn, few social interactions, rigid sexual expectations, and physical stress related, injury, sleep problems, nutritional low weight gain, substance abuse, smoking, chronic pain, hypertension, inadequate prenatal care, miscarriage, preterm labor, fetal fracture, fetal death, placental abruption, and uterine rupture. So as trauma in her life or trauma in her household is going on, the high toxic stress that she experiences, these are the things that we could see in a doctor's office, physical stress related. And just by asking some of those empathy questions, we will be able to pick up on is she going out with friends? Is she only staying at home with her kids? Does her husband allow her to out of the house? How does she feel about herself? How does she view herself? Just by asking empathy questions will often lead into what are these stress-related concerns that she's experiencing in my office? We'll also, domestic assaults. You will see those most frequently on the torso and the head of a woman. As the exposure to trauma increases, so do her ACE scores. So just because she's now an adult does not mean that she's not developing more ACE scores. So if she came into your office as an 18-year-old and she had 4 ACE scores already, she's in an abusive relationship, her partner and her use substances together, that's 2 more ACE scores. So she is at 6 ACE scores now. Women who reported physical, sexual, or emotional abuse during pregnancy were more likely than non-abused women to give birth to a baby with low birth rate, odds ratio 1.4, 95% confidence interval 1.1 to 1.8. The rates of abuse among women, 40 to 65% of sexual assault, physical assault is 32 to 58%. 90% of women that are in treatment have reported a history of domestic violence. 75% of domestic violence incidences involve alcohol use by the victim, the perpetrator, or even both. So 107 seconds. According to the U.S. Department of Justice National Crime Victimization Survey, there's an average of 293.66 victims, 12 or older, that are victims of rape and sexual assault every year. There are 525,600 minutes in a non-leap year. That makes 31,563 seconds a year. So 31,563 divided by 293.66 is one sexual assault every 7 seconds. Domestic violence in Kentucky. Our stats are a little bit behind just because that's how national data reports them. So between July 1, 2013 and June 30, 2014, Kentucky shelters had 3,295 victims of abuse and their children in their shelters. 40% of them were children. Kentucky programs provided 119,718 bed nights. One in nine women in Kentucky has been a victim of forcible rape. And when you introduce substances into that, it gets even higher. We often think she's pregnant, things will get better. Or you hear her say, if I get pregnant, he'll change, things will get better. But pregnancy is not a protective factor from interpersonal violence. Some providers are nervous about asking about violence because they think it'll make them more traumatized. But a lot of times the woman is often waiting for you to ask so she can find a way out. It's a very uncomfortable topic, but if us as professionals, their support systems don't ask them, a lot of times they don't have a support system in their life that will help them. You will see physical stress related problems, injury, sleep problems, nutrition, low weight gain, substance use, smoking, miscarriage, preterm labor, anxiety, depression, suicide, isolation, withdrawal, and few social interactions. Complex issues with substance use during pregnancy. So as we said, pregnancy does not say that everything's going to get better. Issues facing drug-using pregnant women and their children. They have a higher exposure to violence and trauma. A lot of times it's generational. So if she used, most likely her mother is using during pregnancy. Or there's a long history of their living with people that are using substances in the home. They often have low acquisition of jobs, low maintenance skills, a male-focused household. So the mother stays home because they have multiple children. Heightened levels of legal involvement. Multiple drug exposures, potential history of child abuse and neglect, and the list goes on. The biggest one that we often don't ask about is food. Because if there is stress surrounding food in the home, it's usually because they don't have the money to buy the food. So this is the reason in which nutrition in the mother is low. That baby is not going to develop as quickly or is going to be underweight in utero. Because the money is going towards buying their substance of choice. And because there is a potential history of felonies with this population that are drug related, they don't qualify for some of the subsidies that the government offers. Addiction. So the ASAM definition of addiction is a primary chronic disease of brain reward, motivation, memory, and related circuitry. Addiction is characterized by inability to consistently abstain, impairment in behavioral control, cravings, diminished recognition of significant problems with one's behavior and interpersonal relationships, and dysfunctional emotional response. There's often multiple cycles of relapse within addiction. They will often enter into recovery and be doing well, and then relapse again. The highest rate of relapse is in women, and that's often because they are encouraged or sometimes forced to use substances if their partner is still using. A lot of times women will say that the first time they ever injected heroin is when their partner did it for them. So based on the ASIM definition, babies are not born addicted. We see this a lot and we hear this a lot, that baby's addicted. That baby cannot have impairment in behavioral control. He doesn't seek out that drug. He doesn't have dysfunctional emotional response. It is either substance exposed, drug substance endangered, prenatally exposed, drug substance affected, or just in withdrawal. Women differ from men. Their initiation of drug use is different. As we just mentioned, a lot of times they use because their partner is using, or they began using because their partner is using. If they don't abstain from using substances during pregnancy, sometimes it's because their partner doesn't want to use alone and they get in trouble if they don't use with them. That's what we hear the most in the Kids Now Plus program. And so it's just easier to give in and just drink a beer while he's drinking. How she received treatment from drug use is different as well. So women are more likely to have co-occurring drug use and mental health disorders. Their rates of trauma are a lot higher. They often self-medicate with substances. They have higher levels of anxiety and depressive disorders. And they have higher levels of PTSD. So if you think back to those ACE scores, ACE are trauma, things they've experienced in their life. And for women, they often feel that trauma repeatedly in different settings over and over. Drug-dependent women are more likely than drug-dependent men to have partners who use drugs. Some women continue using alcohol and illicit drugs to have an actively in common with their partners, as we mentioned before. So this is, we often say we need to stop the cycle, but we don't really know what the cycle looks like. So it starts with their adverse childhood experiences, family dysfunction, child abuse, moves into toxic stress, and then as a child, we have to learn to fight, flight, or freeze. Often looks like ADHD, bullying, learning disabilities, behavior disorders in our children, when in fact they have toxic stress all around them and they don't know how to manage it. As an adolescent, fight, flight, or freeze increases. That's when teen smoking, teen pregnancy, drug use, and alcohol also increases. And that's when they get the conduct disorder diagnosis or they get the out-of-control diagnosis because they are living in toxic stress. Then they move into an adult, and their risky behaviors increases. They have higher levels of depression. They are suicidal or have already attempted suicide before they ever become an adult. Difficulty at work. Then, if they're a woman, they get pregnant. Then that baby is born as substance exposed or neonatal abstinence syndrome. Then if she doesn't enter treatment, she may have a small recovery window when she's pregnant and because she has decided that she doesn't want substances in her body while she's pregnant. As soon as that baby's born, she relapses. That's also when depression, domestic violence, legal custody issues, DCBS gets involved. So this is the cycle. So a substance-exposed infant has automatically, the day that it's born, developed its ACE scores. That's when they experience domestic violence in the home, they have mental health disorders in the home, they see substance use, their parents are separated or they're in jail. Then that baby starts experiencing toxic stress. So those ACE scores didn't stop with the mom, she passed them on to the baby. So we've got two cycles in one home. But we need to break the cycle. That's all of our jobs is helping professionals is we want to break that cycle. So we've started with the adverse childhood experiences. We're moving to toxic stress. the child. So then we're the adult. This baby is born, and we're going to try to get her into treatment and recovery services. By getting her into treatment and recovery services, she can bond with that baby. She can enter into recovery. She can get on the path that she wants to be on with this baby, not filled with adverse childhood experiences. And by stopping the cycle, we are having a positive attachment with that baby. The brain is getting hardwired the way it needs to be. It's not going to be bottom heavy. And these childhood adverse experiences are going to be stopping, which means this baby is now safe. So how do we get these women into treatment? It's not as easy as it is with men because they come with baggage. And baggage means children a lot of times. It also means that their ACE scores are very different in most cases from men. They've been raped, they've been sexually assaulted. They cannot make that connection in an AA group with a man. They just don't get it. So women enter treatment more ways than men enter treatment typically. Here are the referral sources there on the pie chart. The doctor is the one that prescribes or asks them to go to treatment most often. Then a family friend says, I went to this place, they were great, you should go and try it out, they'll really help you. A hospital is typically they've had a problem, they've overdosed, or they've delivered, and now is the time to get treatment. Or others. Others can be community resource, it can be your hands worker, it could be DCBS, it could be a friend at the library that you've met that is a professional. Barriers to entering treatment. What are some of the internal, external barriers that women may be facing getting into treatment? Fear of stigma or judgment, which we touched base on in the beginning. Accessibility to treatment. I know that our far western and far eastern counties, treatment is limited. It is also limited if you're a mother of three and you need residential treatment. You can't take your children with you because there's maybe three or four places in Kentucky that allow you to do that right now. Hopefully, we're working on growing that possibility. Depression and anxiety may increase during pregnancy and postpartum period. Transportation finances. If you don't have anywhere to get back and forth to your intensive outpatient therapy, then you're seen as non-compliant, especially if you have a DCBS worker. You have to make it work. How are you going to get there? Previous bad experience with the healthcare provider. So if they went in for their first OB checkup, and their nurse or their doctor made them feel stigmatized, they weren't worth getting treatment, no one cared about them, their chance of going back decreases significantly. Fear of child protective services. Now, this one is a real one. If I go into treatment, then they have to make a report that I'm using substances around my children or while I'm pregnant. They'll come take my baby once it's born. We can't say that this doesn't happen because we know it does happen. But we are working as the Department of Behavioral Health with DCBS to improve this, to improve the way that we look at what is considered okay, what is considered harm reduction. Because if everything is doing very well, she's in treatment, she may have used substances during her pregnancy, but right now she's in treatment, she's receiving services. There should be no reason in which that baby is taken when it's born just because of something she did 2 months ago. So that is something that we're working with local agencies and getting a better understanding of substance use and how we can help these women versus making it a problem or criminalization. Because the biggest thing is we want a healthy baby, we want a healthy home. So here's what treatment typically looks like for women. Treatment the first time. They'll get case management, peer support, transportation, stable housing, nutrition, life skills, parenting, job coaching, medical care. We'll load them up. We'll give them everything. Then they relapse. They come back and they say, oh my gosh, I relapsed. I used substances this weekend. She's beating herself up. Look what decreases. Then we get her into treatment, but we're not going to give her as much as we gave her the first time because she didn't use it how she was supposed to. Then she relapses again because she's not wrapped completely with every possibility that she has. She relapses, then she comes back, and we're like, well, you didn't use it. We're only going to give you case management and treatment. Then she relapses again and could potentially overdose. The continuum of a care should increase, but right now what we're seeing is they're decreasing. So it should look like treatment one, treatment two, treatment three should all get the same thing. Because that's just the nature of the beast, is they're gonna relapse. But we have to be there to help them every single time, the same way we did the very first time. Does it get frustrating? It does. But I couldn't imagine being in their shoes and getting frustrated and angry with myself because I couldn't make it work. So the model that works is wraparound. We want to wrap every support we have for them. We want to give them trauma and addiction treatment. We want to give them child care and transportation. We want to give them vocational rehabilitation, housing, and legal aid. We want to give them parenting education early. We want to give them medical care, OBGYN, psychiatry, and we want to give them case management, nutrition, and life skills. And that kind of leads into the Kids Now Plus program, because this here is what they do. Kids Now Plus is a program that's aimed at pregnant women who are at risk for alcohol use or other drugs during their pregnancy or are currently using substances during their pregnancy. They have, for those that are at risk, we have prevention programs. So if they live in a home with someone that is their boyfriend is currently using but they're not using, or they've stopped their use prior to getting pregnant, or they come from a family that uses or had high levels of domestic violence in the home, we have universal, selective, and indicated programs that help with that. Kids Now Plus and harm reduction. We want to reduce the use of alcohol, tobacco, and other drugs. When they come to the Kids Now Plus program, they're not all ready to just stop cold turkey. So we need to meet them where they're at. If that means that they decrease their alcohol intake by 8 beers a week to 4 beers a week, that's harm reduction. That's better than nothing. Because then the more we work with them, hopefully we can decrease that alcohol intake to even less. We want health birth outcomes. And by doing harm reduction, we can take them from a high risk to a low risk. So I know this is really small, but these are the goals that we hope to reach as Kids Now Plus. We hope to increase community education, help referral sources, make connections with our doctor's offices, with our HANDS programs, with case management. We hope to offer Medicaid billable services to these ladies, because with Medicaid expansion in Kentucky, a lot of them have available services that they are not familiar with. We want to increase their readiness for treatment while encouraging them abstinence or reduction of alcohol and tobacco and other drugs. So prevention services that we offer, sometimes you'll hear the title baby shower. So your local community mental health centers who offers the Kids Now Plus program, and they have what they call baby showers. That's where a medical provider, someone in the community, makes a referral to the community mental health center, and then they invite these ladies to come for a prevention class. Usually they start with Universal, because anyone can go to a Universal class as long as they don't have a substance use diagnosis already. So they go in and they'll do drawings while they're there, while they're getting this prevention material on why using substances or misusing substances during your pregnancy is not a good thing to do. So they will give out gift cards to them, they will give baby items, sometimes they'll even do a drawing for a crib, pack and play, that kind of thing. So here's our three levels. We have universal, selective, and indicated. So universal is you can refer any pregnant woman in your program or your clinic to universal classes, because being pregnant in itself is stressful and could lead to alcohol, tobacco, other use. So being pregnant is a risk factor. Selective is a pregnant woman who indicates no alcohol or drug use within the last 30 days, but is at an increased risk for substance abuse problems. So she found out 30 days ago she was pregnant, and she immediately stopped using substances. But her boyfriend, her husband, or her mom or dad that she lives with currently still uses substances. Indicated is a pregnant woman who fits the following criteria. She currently or has used alcohol or tobacco drugs since learning of her pregnancy. She currently has exhibited problematic behaviors due to pregnancy associated with substance use. She currently or has exhibited risk factors that increase her chances of developing substance use problems and meets the criteria for a substance use related disorder, but hasn't been diagnosed yet, even though she meets that criteria. She hasn't had a formal assessment. The thing that you guys don't have to worry about is which category they fit into. Kids Now Plus folks will make that determination for you, as long as you just make the referral and get these ladies where they need to go. Case management is the second portion of the Kids Now Plus program. Case management is for those ladies who have a substance use disorder. So if they come into the office and the doctor has diagnosed them with a substance use disorder, or in the past they were diagnosed because they have been seen by a therapist before, they would qualify for a case management. And with case management, they hope to reduce their ACE scores, break the cycle, and get those ladies ready for treatment. They will also meet their basic needs. They, all around the little bubble here in blue, they work on. They're an advocate. They work towards recovery. They work towards giving back to the community, whether that means get these ladies employed or help them find some volunteer work. They do job coaching. They do counseling with them. They will work with the family, as long as they have consent from the mother, to do family therapy. Family financial resources, if they need hands or WIC, they will get them set up. If they need Medicaid, they will help them get that set up. They will also, if they have a spiritual or need spiritual enrichment, they're a part of a church, they will help them get more engaged with the church community if that's something that they wish to do. So they are wrapping, I don't know what happened. Sorry, my PowerPoint disappeared. Oh, there we go.
There it is. Okay.
So they will wrap around the client everywhere possible, because moms don't just need substance use treatment. They need everything for their families a lot of times. So community partners can be OB, medical providers, DCBS, your health departments, educational vocational services, housing, transportation, domestic violence support centers, parenting, legal services, and Kids Now Plus outcomes, quality of life. So every client that comes into the Kids Now Plus program agrees to do a follow-up. So CDAR, with UK, they call Center for Drug and Alcohol Research. They do 6-month and annual follow-ups with these ladies. In exchange for $50 gift card. So they call them at 6 months, they'll call them and ask them a series of questions to see how they're doing. So one of the questions that they ask goes around quality of life indicators. They ask the ladies how confident they are about taking care of their newborn. 60% of the clients, after they graduated or completed the Kids Now Plus program, said they felt very confident at their baseline report. Then 94% upon graduation or completion said they felt as though they were more prepared. Perceptions about how difficult life would be is with the baby. Beginning of treatment or entering into case management, 20% of them said the clients felt like their life with the baby would not be very difficult and very fairly manageable at baseline. Only 20%. After completion, 54% said that they felt like their life was manageable with the baby. Quality of life perceptions. So ratings were from 1 worst imaginable to 5 good and bad parts were about equal to, and then 10 best manageable. So at baseline, which is beginning of treatment, 6.4 said their quality of life was about a 6.4 out of 10. And then after Kids Now Plus, 8.2 was what they rated themselves on their quality of life. This is substance use. This is comparing 6 months before the client became pregnant and the past 6 months of postnatal follow-up. So 49% at baseline, clients reported illegal drug use, 49%. That decreased to 10% of clients at the 6 months follow-up. 52% of clients reported alcohol use at baseline. That's beginning of case management. That decreased at the 6 months post follow-up to 15%. 79% of clients reported smoking cigarettes at baseline. We all know this is the hardest one to get rid of. That did decrease to 65%. So even though it's a still higher number, it was a decrease. It's harm reduction. The outcomes of the Kids Not Plus mothers. Kids Not Plus case management clients compared to the general population of mothers. So Kids Not Plus is there on the left. The general population is on the right. Average gestational age is 38.3 weeks. Average gestational age of general population, exact same. Average birth weight, 7 pounds, 2 ounces, not far. 1 ounce difference from the average of the general population. The average APGAR score is 8.9. Average APGAR score of general population is 8.8. Average of 12.9 prenatal visits in the Kids Now Plus clients with an average of 11.8 prenatal visits. So what this says is we engage these ladies, we wrap around them with supports and services, we stabilize their environment, we do harm reduction or completely get rid of substances in their life. They are, on average, very similar, if not identical, to the general population. So when they first walk into our office and we see that they are handling life not so great, they've got some substance use concerns, a lot of times people automatically just shut it off as their lost cause. But this here shows that if we can get them in, we can wrap around them. They can balance out just like anyone else. Kids Not Plus satisfaction ratings. So this is, we ask them about their program. What did you like about your program? What did you not like about your program? And these were the results. 99% learned about the risks of tobacco, alcohol, and drugs during their pregnancy. 95% felt their mental health had improved. 95% of mental health. That's, when you think of those A scores and they walked in with fours and fives, 95% is really high. 92% felt safer from intimate partner violence. 96% believe they had a healthier pregnancy than they would have without Kids Not Plus. And 98% felt better about themselves after participation. So self-esteem, self-worth, and our environments were much better if we're feeling better about ourselves at 98%. So this is a follow-up client. It was helpful. My case manager helped me get the services I needed to have a better pregnancy, which is our main goal, is have healthier pregnancies and healthy babies. So referrals to Kids Now Plus. This is the map. We've recently expanded Kids Now Plus from 8 regions to all regions now. This is an older map we just confirmed with Bluegrass, which is there in the center where the butterfly is, that they are coming on board as of January 1 with Kids Now Plus. They do have right now the Pride program, which is very similar to Kids Now Plus. So this map will be updating on our website. If you go to dvhdid.ky.gov, there is a Kids Now Plus website that you can access this. You can also access the program manual if you're interested in seeing the ins and outs of what our case managers do. So making a referral. In the packets and the handouts that were sent to you guys about my presentation, there is a general Kids Now Plus referral sheet. I think it's that one right in front of you, Ms. Joy. Uh-huh. And on there, the very beginning gives you the steps to take on making a referral. And it could be slightly different based on your agreements with your local Kids Now Plus program. How we would like to have it is just in the office after you complete your SBIRT or your substance use screening with these ladies and you find that they could benefit from a program such as the Kids Now Plus program. You've talked to them, you've received a release of information for you to make that referral to the Kids Now Plus program. There is the PN2, which is Kids Now Plus folks will refer to as the level one. On the back of that form is a breakdown of SBIRT if you need it. It gives you all the language that you need on the back of the PN2 to do an SBIRT assessment. If you choose not to use the SBIRT assessment, we will take any substance use assessment that you do in your office with that client. If you do a screening or an assessment, we will take it. So if you have a family planning form that says that ask 4 or 5 substance use questions, let's say, on there, if, as long as you get the release of information to give us the copy of that form so we exactly know what you've asked, we will accept that as a screener form for the Kids Not Plus program. If you have another form that you use, we'll take that too. So we're not strictly held down to using the PN2 form as a referral. So on here is all 14 regions that are currently have active contracts with the state for the Kids Now Plus program. That is on the map of Kentucky. They have the contact person, sometimes that's a substance use director, or the leader of that program. And I will be sending out this along with another packet, kind of like a Kids Now Plus packet, to all health departments here, I would say within the next 4 weeks or so. Everyone will get, and I will try to highlight who your contact person is for your health department, what region you're in. So then that way, when you want to send someone, you know exactly who you need to call to get that person into your office. If you want to refer every pregnant woman you have to that universal class, that is completely acceptable. There are some OBs that do that. And that just ensures that everyone has supports, regardless of where they are experiencing, because as a mom, I know I can always use extra hands. So, and that's what the Kids Now Plus is there for, is we're there to help them have healthy environments and healthy babies. I think that is end of my presentation. Does anybody have any questions for me, or did I use any lingo that maybe you guys are not familiar with? I know that medical world and behavioral health world is sometimes a little bit different.
Are there any questions from the field for Katie?
Okay. I hope I didn't go too fast.
Nope. Perfect. Are you from the room for Katie?
Do you all have any questions?
Thank you, Katie, so much for your valuable information.
And if there's anything else you guys need, we have tons of programs we can help you guys.
Okay, we appreciate it. Appreciate your partnership.
Thank you.
All right, thank you. Have a great day.
You too.
Next, I'll ask Emily Anderson to come up. Emily is the program director for the TB Prevention and Control Program here at the Department for Public Health. And she has information to share with us today regarding the recent revisions to the TB regulations. So, Emily, thank you for coming today and sharing your valuable information with the nurses. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Joy. Good morning, everyone. We'll take this moment as we start loading the presentation. Please do not be freaked out, I guess, to say about the length of this presentation. This presentation is used for multiple training purposes, and it's very lengthy, as I said. So we're just going to focus on what local health department personnel need to know. But Joy's correct. Back this spring, in March 4th, 2016, we are very proud to say that we had one of our regulations updated and then one created. So the goal, why did we do this? For the past 3.5 years, we've been working to see if we could streamline and update the regulations to meet the 2005 CDC TB guidelines that, of course, the CCSG, we at the local level, right, have always been updated. But out in the world, hospitals, long-term care facilities, correction facilities, they really needed to have the regulations streamlined to meet those guidelines. As I mentioned, the regulations were effective March 4th. That's when they kind of caught us off guard across the river, as we say in Frankfurt, with the legislative process. It passed a lot quickly than we anticipated. We anticipated that it was supposed to go through both the House and Senate Health and Welfare Committees, and it was passed smooth sailing through the Regulation Committee. So that very day, the 4th, it was effective. So on behalf of the different associations, requested that they have 6 months to implement at their facilities. So implementation date was August 31st. So in that time, you know, it's just myself and Maria, the nurses in the program. So we had to develop very quickly an awareness campaign to use throughout the state. And that's what we did. And so that's really what I'm going to focus on today. So those two regulations, number one, this was the new regulation that was created, and it was 902-KAR-2205, TB testing for healthcare workers. We used the CDC definition of healthcare worker, and that we've all been using in public health all these years. And then we updated the 902-KAR-2200, which is TB testing for residents of long-term care facilities or settings. So I'm going to just kind of, you can look at all of these slides yourself if you're really interested on the differences, but I'll just kind of give you a quick overview. For healthcare workers, the new definitions were healthcare worker and staggered testing. And remember, staggered testing for larger facilities, it's very important, especially if you have a contact investigation, that you stagger those testing, annual testing, throughout the year. You don't want a large healthcare facility to do all their employee testing in 1 month. We give suggestions for testing based on your hire date or the employee's birth date, or you develop another system quarterly, however, you know, based on the different areas in that hospital maybe. But staggered testing is really the standard that CDC recommends for large-based health employee testing. And then new to out in the world was to have an infection control program plan. And we gave them some really good resources on how to develop those plans. And we all know in the public health world that you need to identify who needs to be annual tested every year. If you have, of course, your nurses, physicians, PAs that are seeing everyone, your medication assistants, maybe is there a volunteer that regularly goes into that patient's room? Dietary, are they bringing trays into the room? So they have to actually list those individuals in their plan. And for some reason, that was a new concept for them. I thought that always been around. I know. And so that's where we just kind of list. And what we did in our awareness program, we developed, and I'll show you as we go along in this slide program, we developed a multifaceted campaign. And we knew that there's different learning concepts. Everybody learns material a different way. Sometimes they need to actually see it in different formats. And so we developed nice little summaries, and you all may have seen that in our special edition newsletter that was disseminated in June of this year. And we had FAQs, and every time we did something, we would boldly print in red "new." So it was very clear as they were looking, this is what's new and pertinent. So I'm going to just keep on going. Excuse me while I get to my pages here. Okay, so what do you need to know at the local health department level? You know they report to you already. So when they're talking about they have identified a healthcare worker that has now converted from a negative TST to now a positive TST on their annual screening. They have to determine why, you know, kind of look in-house, what happened, were they exposed to anyone, but they also should be letting you all know that they have had a conversion, and that is in the law. So you'll get those phone calls, and what do you do with that? Just like you're doing now. You go ahead and say, okay, what have you done? Have you is it connected to a case that you're already aware of? And just a little investigative work, but really, That's their employee, and so it's their responsibility at that time. It's not a case, right? Okay. And then Section 11 talks about the treatment for LTBI, so they may have some questions for you at the local level as far as what that treatment consists of. We are training them, the healthcare workers throughout the state. We have done the HAI boot camp in April. So that was all of the IPs throughout the state were there, and we gave them training on the guidelines. We have, throughout the whole 3 years, we've engaged all of our partners in helping develop the regulations. So they were very well prepared when the regulations were passed, what the content of it was. But we're also going to be training the OIG surveyors next week here in Frankfurt. They're having their own ITV. And so we'll be going over the same slides so that they know particularly what to look at when they're actually doing their audits, when they go out, or surveys, I believe they call them. And then we also will be training the Long-Term Care Association in November so that they will have all of that information too.
And Emily, I wanted to let you know that this information was sent out to the local health department regional EPIs.
Oh, great.
So they'll have this information ready.
Great. Great. And so, Joy, if you didn't hear that, Joy said that the information was also sent out today to the regional EPIs because they may be actually the ones receiving the call in some areas of the state. Okay, I'm going to keep moving on because I just want to cover what's really going to impact the local health departments. And again, in the long-term care reg, they have the reporting also. So if you have a long-term care facility in your county, again, if they have a conversion of a resident on their annual screening, or as they're being admitted, they would report that to you also. The biggest, I think, addition to or a concept that we are regularly identify with in the public health world is a verbal risk assessment. You do it for the lead program. We do it on the HMP 13. We do it on the TB HMP 13. But then for TB, we have the TB 4, which is the TB risk assessment. But in the public or the private sector, I guess, the hospitals and long-term care, they're not used to doing a verbal risk assessment. And so we've had to do a lot of training on really what that does. You know, that's where you identify the risk. Have they been traveled? Have they been exposed? Have they been diagnosed with a chronic illness to where they're possibly immunocompromised? And then are they having signs and symptoms? And so this risk assessment, we shared with them our TB4, and that was a little daunting, I think, because that's used mostly for our case management. So we also shared the CDC LTBI risk assessment, but basically in the regulation, we said they could come up with their own. But realize that, again, they may have questions about that and contact you at the local level. To what is this risk assessment and how do I use it? But really the concept, as we know, is that identifies the risk and then that tells you what your next step is going to be. So here's our, that was the CDC sample that we shared with them. And then, of course, there's our TB4. And the screening criteria, we shared that. The awareness campaign, we also did online training modules with Train. This was just a wonderful experience with David Knapp and Joa McDaniel. We had so much fun developing these training modules, and I had no idea what actually, how lengthy that would be, and just what a complex process behind the scenes to get what looks like just some slides, like a PowerPoint slide, into an actual training module. And we didn't have time to put our voices into it because, again, this was expedited, the whole awareness campaign, so we had to get the information out there. But we're really proud of these two training modules. We take actually this PowerPoint and just go step by step what we're doing now. And it's interactive, and they have some questions with it and a little evaluation at the end. So it's really nice. But those are just some screenshots and actual links if you're interested in viewing those. Or again, you may get questions and actually help one of those agencies find that as a resource for them. In the toolkit, we had, of course, the special edition newsletter. And not only do our newsletters go out to all of you at the local level, they go out to the regional EPIs, they go out to infection control and preventionists at all the hospitals across the state, all of the long-term care infection preventionists, the correctional facilities. The list, if you were to add up, I think it's over 1,000 individuals that our newsletter goes to. And then we did the highlights. Again, that's where we just took each section of the regulation and just kind of said in plain English, this is what changed, or this was new, or this is pertinent for you. Because we know sometimes regulations can be pretty daunting to read. And then we did FAQs. Over the past 3 years, pretty much any question that had came into us, we summarized that question for the each regulation. And so we thought that that was a really good idea. And then we compiled an entire resource list of anything that we had developed or CDC that would be pertinent to the two regulations so that they would have all of those links at their fingertips. This was, again, why they had to implement an infection control program. A little more structured than I think they were used to. I'm just going to go through this quickly. We gave them this resource, which was a large practical manual for preventing TB to help them establish and make sure they were following good protocols for their infection plan. So, directly, these two regulations have no direct impact at all on the local health departments because you're not regulated by OIG. Only agencies that are regulated by OIG really have to comply with these regulations. Are the regulations good practice? Yes. So some agencies out in the state have been calling us and we've been saying, really, you're not regulated, like a nursing school, staffing agencies, they're not regulated. However, they have healthcare workers, right? You have nursing students, you have instructors going out. They really should use these regulations of standards to follow. And again, this guidance is for healthcare workers since 2005. It's nothing new to us. But, and here's the but, when I went back and looked so that I could find the reference in the AR, it says it refers to the TB program section of the CCSG, and it's not in there. So over the next several months, we will get that information back into the CCSG or the AR. So hold on tight. And really, again, it's just telling you the best practice that we're already doing. We're doing annual testing. However, we got some recommendations for you, too. We want you to continue to build those strong community relationships and partnerships. We've had some questions from the field, from local health departments, saying, such and such hospitals called me, and they're expecting me to provide the medications and do the follow-up on their employee that now has tested positive for a TST. Is that really our role? Well, it could be your role. You don't have to. It's not on the do or assure module, right? But you could provide that, and you can do it through a contractual agreement with that agency. So it's a way for your health department to collaborate with that community agency, a hospital, long-term care, whatever little agency is in your community or large agency, but pretty much it's those smaller agencies and smaller counties. And you know, develop a way and say, okay, we can actually even do the training for you. you know, help train your new IP, or maybe even doing the TSTs for you, you know, actually, because you have so few individuals. And so it's just a way to build that relationship and maybe gain a little revenue. If you're already maybe testing the fire department or the local police department, this is just another example of how you can reach out and maybe provide some education or make a little money on, and also. So this was one of the things. And we shared this in June in our newsletter, how the local health departments were impacted. This is word for word from what we shared in June. And I'll show this one. If the healthcare facility does not employ licensed professional staff with technical training to carry out the screening and monitoring requirements, this is taken directly from the regulation, it says that training or professional assistance shall be arranged with the local health department or from a licensed medical provider. We're giving them that information of who to reach out to collaborate with to get the training. Do you have to? It's not a should, it's a shall. And so that's a way to, again, create further relationships. Section 11 in the regulation actually indicates that employees diagnosed with LTBI shall be offered management and treatment in collaboration with the local health department. So we want them to either reach out to you for if they have questions about anything, if they're unsure how to treat, you can help guide them on the different treatment regimens for LTBI, or perhaps even make those collaborative agreements or memorandums of agreement, contractual agreements, whichever you decide, if you actually want to help do the actual occupational health screenings each year for them. So, getting close to the end. Just remember that they are still required to report to you. LTBI is not reportable. However, if it is a conversion they have been identified, that employee has been identified as a contact to a case, that's reportable. That's what we're telling them to report to you. We cannot modify our protocols, our guidelines, our training strategic plans for the next year for TB cases unless we know, you know, what the prevalence of LTBI is in your community. It will help guide you and to know if your LTBIs are going up, very possibly you're going to have more cases in your community, because we know that with the comorbidities associated with TB, we're seeing more and more individuals having a higher risk of developing TB from their LTBI infection as they grow older and have less management with those comorbidities. So we are seeing that across the state. Of course, we, as you know, we have higher incidence now of multi-drug resistance TB. So again, those comorbidities can impact that if they're not responding well to their medications, if they're not compliant because they have so many different chronic illnesses and so many different medications. It's just when they start taking the TB medications, they become overwhelmed, and they can actually develop a resistance because of poor compliance. So we are seeing that. This has been feedback we've received from the new regulations has been good. We've had very few questions regarding the healthcare worker regulation. Most has been regarding the long-term care residents, and simply because some of those were new concepts for them, the risk assessment. One thing we did take away was the fact that CDC recommends that if you're a past previous positive and you have documentation for that and your risk assessment, you don't have a further risk and you don't have signs and symptoms, then you don't need that annual chest x-ray. And so that's going to be a huge cost saving for all of these establishments. But if you have identify a risk on the risk assessment, if you identify some signs and symptoms, that's when you would do the chest x-ray again. I want to thank everyone out in the state. You do a marvelous job. We are just so proud of the work that everyone does. We give you shout-outs when we're at national conventions, regional conventions. Maria and Dr. Brawley were just at Nashville a week ago, and you know, Kentucky in the TV world, we're in the top five, and we're very proud of that. We have other states in the nation that are actually calling us for our protocols and guidelines in the CCSG. We're sharing our forms. We're sharing our success stories because we do a good job. And when I say we, I mean you out in the field. You're doing excellent. It takes a team. So that's all I have. If anyone has any questions, if it's specific to your health department, you know you can just call myself or Maria. But if it's an overall question, I'll take those now. Again, I'm sorry this PowerPoint was a little overwhelming, but we can't develop six different PowerPoints, so we just decided to use them all. But we thank you. Thank you, Joy, for this opportunity, sure, to share.
Thanks, Emily, for speaking today. And it looks like you have really done an extensive job with all the training venues and through it with all the partners across the state. So thanks for your all's hard work and getting the word out about the new regulations.
You're welcome, and thank you for also helping, because we have to get you to help with those different listservs for us.
Oh, yeah.
To get those nurses. So thank you all.
Thanks, Sam. Let's see if you're going to do that for me. Okay, thanks, Casey. Next, I'll ask Benita Decker, who is the Family Planning and Adolescent Health Program Coordinator, to come up and speak to us today. Benita is doing an encore performance of information that she shared at the recent APRN conference, which I feel like, if you haven't heard from your APRNs, I really feel like the APRN conference was a huge success, and thanks to you all, the nurse leaders and other leadership, the directors who allow the APRNs to attend the conference. But this is one of the presentations that we did share with the APRNs on the latest and greatest in the family planning program. So I invited Benita, since you already had the slides all ready to go, to come back and speak at the ITV. So here she is, and thank you, Benita.
Thank you, Joy. The information we provided for the APRNs was, and thank you all for listening, the information we provided at the APRN conference is really for all of you all out in the clinic. So that's why, you know, we wanted to share this information. This presentation is broken into two parts, and so hang on to your questions. We'll go through the first section, then you can ask questions if you have any, and then we'll go into the second section, which is on coding and billing, and I can almost guarantee you'll have questions, and so we'll hang on to that. We'll split it up. Okay, so let's get started. First of all, I want you to make QFP a household word in your clinic, meaning quality family planning. Quality family planning is the document I hope you have somewhere in your clinic. It's the document you see on the screen. It is the family planning recommendations developed by CDC. It is more than recommendations. They now call them CDC and the Office of Population Affairs calls it their guidelines. It's our standards of care for family planning. It is what they judge us by and how well we do our job. When we had a site visit in July, they follow this document and say, hey, you know, what do you know about this? And they'd ask people in the clinic, the workers in the clinic, do you know what QFP is? And unfortunately, a lot of them said, no, we don't know what that is. But they didn't say what's Quality Family Planning Services document. So we need to make QFP a household word. And so it outlines how we do Quality Family Planning Services. It's our standard of care, as I've said. And so if you do not have this document in your clinic, at your nurse's station, please email me and I will make sure we get you a document. But There's an app for that. And so you can either, you'll have to talk to your IT folks. There is an app that you can put it right on your desktop, that you can put this on the desktop, or you can even put it on your phone. You can go to Google Store, or you can go to the App Store. It's free. Download it onto your cell phone. I used it yesterday. Someone out in the field, and you may even be listening, asked me about pregnancy tests as regarding in regards to contraceptive methods. And so I looked at two or three little pushes with my finger on my cell phone at the QFP site, and it gave me exactly the information that I needed and the guidelines and the standards of care for family planning patients. So this is a great app. I use it at least once a week. And instead of having to flip through a big document and try and find it anywhere, it's all organized really nicely. In fact, the first page looks like this when you get into it. So you can click contraceptive services, pregnancy testing, and then it gives you some different levels and areas to look at for that. It's really a great user-friendly app, and I want to encourage all of you to either download it on your phone or download it on your desktop in your nurse's station. I also want to talk about the fact that family planning services are for females and males of reproductive age, and they have the ability to reproduce. And the reason I say that is when we evaluated back in July, August, September, it took us a long time, all the charges that were put through as we went through this first year of reimbursement for fee service, you know, we went through there and we looked, and we found clients in the 802 cost center that were 90. We found clients in the 802 cost center that were 8. And did not get any kind of family planning service, and everything in between. So, so I want to emphasize one that to call them a family planning client, they have to have the ability to reproduce. This does include people who've had sterilizations because it's still only 99.5% effective. So, and I know working in labor and delivery, I've delivered several babies in my life that were to women or men who had had vasectomies or tubals. But if they've had a hysterectomy or they don't have an ability to reproduce, you can't count them as a family planning patient. If they're menopausal, that type of thing. But anyone else, they can. I also want to emphasize the fact that guys, males, are family planning patients. You have a man who comes in for an STD check. He is a family planning patient because family planning services are services for, hold on, I'll be back. Let me get that. I'll go back. It's somewhere. We'll skip it. Family planning services are for people who need contraceptive care, need infertility services, need help achieving pregnancy, it was right in front of me, and who have sexually transmitted diseases, okay, or related preventative health services. So you can count your men as family planning patients. In fact, I encourage you to do so. And so everybody who comes through your door who is considered a family planning patient, whether they're 14 years old or 40 years old and they're there for whatever reason, they need to be asked the reproductive life plan history, which is three questions. Do you plan to have any or any more children at any time in your future? How many children would you like to have? How long would you like to wait until you or your partner become pregnant? And then so if they don't want to become pregnant, what family planning method do you plan to use until you or your partner become pregnant? So you need to ask them what methods they're using, okay? And then also ask them how sure they are to be able to use this method without any problems. A guy says, well, you know, I'm just going to let her use birth control, or she's got an IUD, or I'm just going to use a condom. You want to make sure you say, and how sure are you that that's going to work, okay? When you document those questions, that patient becomes a family planning patient. Okay? You also need to ask a partner's sexual history. Now, these will all be included in the new ECW, or if they are in the first line, they will as we roll out. Okay? So you already check on your history. I ask them a partner history, but the Office of Population Affairs wants more documentation to prove that. So what's a partner history? You're going to ask, what does your partner have a history of STDs, hepatitis B or C, HIV, etc., okay? Do they have a history of multiple sex partners? a history of IV drug use, a history of sex with someone from a high-risk group. What's a high-risk group? And I've listed these there. I'm not going to read them for you. So you want to make sure that you're asking your partner history. And most of you, if not all of you, already are doing that. But somehow you're going to have to document that. When we go to ECW, that will make that a little bit easier. Okay? Also, one of the things that we got we got recommendations on from the Office of Population Affairs at their site visit back in July, is that we need to document and prove that we're doing adolescent counseling. And so I wanted to share with you all what that means, okay? So you have to, what the guidelines are is that Title X providers must provide adolescent counseling, which includes at a minimum counseling on abstinence, family involvement, and sexual coercion. Okay, this comes directly from the QFP. And so the content must include abstinence. You must discuss abstinence as a form of birth control with minors. You know that they'll probably choose another form of birth control, but you need to document, and you are doing that you have discussed abstinence with them. And then it used to say parental involvement, because we know a lot of our teens, that especially coming to our clinics at the health department, may not have a trusted adult in their life that they can talk to, and if that trusted adult is often not their parent. So now they've switched that to family involvement. So you need to encourage, of course, family involvement. We're already doing that, and make sure you document that we are involving, we're encouraging our teens to involve their family and their decisions to seek family planning services. They are still allowed confidential services, but we want to encourage that. And ask them if they have a trusted adult in their life. We know through the Youth Risk Behavior Survey that overall about 15% of our high school teens state that they do not have a trusted adult in their life to talk to about serious problems, okay? And so ask them of that. You may be that trusted adult for them at that time because they don't have anyone supporting them. When you get into teens who make high-risk decisions like drugs, alcohol, sex, et cetera, or are like DF students, then that rate goes up to like 35 to 40% of those teens say they don't have a trusted adult in their life to talk to about serious problems. So kind of be there for them, but encourage them to identify a trusted adult, to identify someone that they can talk to. And then also you're going to talk to them about sexual coercion. And I've had several staff out in the field say, okay, so what does that exactly mean? Okay, thank you all. So I'm going to flip through some of these slides really quick. So I'm not going to go through this, but make sure you're asking your teens to say, and really almost all your clients, or all of your clients where it seems appropriate, especially college age and teens, because of dating violence and other things and just them being coerced, you need to ask them questions, and I've listed them here for you, every family planning visit, and empower them, provide them counseling. And you know, there's some youth-friendly brochures out there. So there's youth-friendly websites out there that you can plug them into. There's one site out there called TTEA, like pouring tea and drinking hot tea, and consent. Tea and consent. Google it. There's two versions. One uses foul language and one doesn't. The shorter one does not use foul language. It's an excellent kind of video that talks about making tea and ties it into consent. And so it's fun. It's fun for anybody. Check it out. But also it's fun to give to your teens and your emerging adults, your college age kids, to show them you don't, you know, yes is yes and no is no. So be proactive in that. Okay, some policy changes. We put these out last week. First of all, desk audits, which were quarterly for KWCSP and family planning, are now every 6 months. You still need to report that in June. You have to send one of those desk audits in June, but you don't have to do them every 3 months. We switch them to 6 months. Also, sterilization reports are not quarterly anymore. You just want to provide us once a year around the same time you're sending in your desk audits. Send us in your sterilization report for the year, and those are for sterilizations provided through the Title X funding. So you don't have to send us that one that says none or one, and then we have to compile. It's just a one-year thing. We wanted to try and find some ways to ease some of the burden of reporting in our program. And there's not a whole lot of places we could do that, but these are two spots that we felt like we could do that. Okay, so before we go to navigating the coding issues, is there any questions?
Would you mind to mention the I and E?
Oh, someone asked us last week about the I and E committee. We did attempt with the Office of Population Affairs to ease that burden too. We were hoping we could just do a state level committee where we brought folks in on the state level. And then not have to do it on a community level. What happened with that is that they said no. They want us to beef up our I&E committees in our local level and add the state level committee. So and there's more information coming in the next month or two about that. But the I&E committees are still required by the federal government, by Office of Population Affairs, and so you all still have to continue with your I&E committees and your outreach and that kind of thing. Okay, so let's get into the nitty-gritty of navigating the coding nightmare. And the reason I want to go through this is that we learned last year when our first year with fee-for-service reimbursement that people weren't getting the optimal reimbursement for their family planning services, especially once we went to ICD-10 coding. Okay, so I thought maybe some guidance on that would help, and then we've done a lot of work around this, and so here's what we want to suggest to you. First of all, with ICD-10, the right primary ICD-10 code is key. In the past, when we evaluated and assessed the 802, all the cost centers and where 802 like methods and things like that were coded to, people would put a primary code as well child, and a team would come in for maybe a well child visit of some sort, and then they also got family planning. So your primary code was your ICD-10 code was a well child code. Well, then the CDP folks don't recognize that as an 802 patient. So it's important that I made you a worksheet that your first code is a family planning code for all your family planning patients, which includes your STD patients. And so, of course, if it's a method, you would just put that method code. I made you all a worksheet for that. But say they're just coming in and they're not going to get a method. That's why I put the counseling codes first on that worksheet. They're coming in and, they're going to get preconception health. They're going to get an STD treatment, but you're not going to give them a method. Start out with a primary code as a counseling code that is approved, because these are the codes that CDP connects to the 802 cost center. And so if you don't do that, like with your STD patients, then they don't get, your labs won't get paid for. But if you make them a family planning patient, we pay for the STD labs. And so it gives you a higher reimbursement for your client. Now, this works, too, with Medicaid, okay? So it's important to choose a family planning ICD-10 code, because that lights up the light bulb for CDP to say, oh, we need all the approved CPT codes for that you check. They will get paid for by the 802 cost center, okay? I don't think there's different guidelines since I did this presentation with the APRNs. We've had lots of conversation, and there shouldn't be different guidelines for third-party billers. I know there's not for Medicaid, but for third-party billers, if there is, then you're going to have to follow that guideline. You know, back in the day, we didn't care what insurance a person had, and of course, it still won't matter for our care of that client, but we do need to see where the insurance is, and are they uninsured? Are they Medicaid? Are they a third-party payer source? Because that will determine how much money you get back, and you want to code your PEF to that particular, make sure that you're doing that in line, or have your billers make sure you do that in line so that you get the most optimal reimbursement. ECW, when we switch to that over the next 6 to 8 months, will ease a lot of this burden. But it'll be a good basis for us as we move forward with them. Then it won't be as complicated with that, but it will still be a process because it's coding, and the rules make it a little as complicated as possible. Okay, so how do you code for a patient when no method is given? Like I said, if they're an SCD patient, or they're a sterilization client for an annual exam, Maybe they're a patient that has a long-acting reversible contraceptive, like an IUD or an implant, and they are just coming in for their annual exam or checkup. Their ASA, which they're using natural family planning, that type of thing. Start out with Z30.09, which is just general counseling. You'll be able to list all the other ICD-10 codes following that, but that wakes up CDP to say, oh, this is a family planning patient. All the approved CPT codes that you check off, then we'll end up paying for, okay? And then, like I said, so you're going to put all your other ICD-10s for that patient following that primary code. You don't have to use a counseling code if you're giving them a method. You can, but definitely if they're not getting a method, use a counseling code as your primary code because they're coming in to get some counseling for whatever, and then they're going forward with whatever you do for them. All right, let's talk about CPT codes. The reason that we're making this happen is because when CDP looks at codes, they pay labs, medications, contraceptive methods, x-rays, all those get paid according to the primary code. So, as I've kind of said, so that's why the primary ICD has to be a family planning code. You know, you're going to still mark your pass and add your other ICD-10 codes. And there is an approved list of CPT codes. I added those too. Those are the codes that we're going to be paying for. Okay? Make sure that you only mark the CPT codes that are on the family planning approved list because, especially for uninsured and no-home contact. If you write in another code, say you think you've got a better CPT code for depo, because this happened a lot, like 87, 78 times, something like that last year when we did the evaluation. Well, I understand that that code, that CPT code, is what you use, your APRN or you use for depo. But if you don't use a code that's on our list, then and you write in a code, then CDP doesn't have that light bulb go off, and they won't pay for it. So then you've lost, you know, sometimes with the IUDs, a couple, you know, $700-$800 and at least $100-$150 for your depo and other things. So make sure you use our codes. If you think there's a CPT code that we need to add to the PEP and to our list, email me. I'll be glad to work on that and get that taken care of. These are according to national standards is how we, you know, this PEP has been made up. It's also how we've chosen our codes. But, you know, we're human and we're fallible. So if you think, oh, we need to add this CPT code or we need to add this ICD-10 code, make sure you email me and we'll see what we can do about that. Okay? So also, what happened, another issue which will be fixed with ECW, but say a patient comes in, like we said, it's a teenager who comes in for a well child visit or an adult preventative visit or vaccinations or TB or whatever, and so, oh, while I'm here, I'm also going to get my birth control, okay? Well, think about maybe if they've got two different issues going on with their visit, filling out two different PEPs. We've been assured that that's okay, and so because that way the one PEP will be for the family planning services, you get reimbursed for that, and then the other PEP will be for the other services. That won't happen real often, but there is that occasion. In fact, when we did the evaluation and assessed how the fee-for-service reimbursement worked through July, August, and September, because we looked at like 72,000 records, in the 802 cost center were TB charges, were vaccinations, were well child visits. We found methods in WIC, and we found, you know, depo and pills and everything, pregnancy tests and WIC and vaccinations and everything else. So because we have to live within the CDP system, consider when you've got multiple things going on with your clients to just have a PEP for your family planning services and a PEP for whatever else so that you can get, and this is also you get money back. So I know it's work, but it also is, you know, what pays the bills. Okay, I know this is a lot and it's confusing, so what questions do you have for me?
This is Amy at Bracken. I just want to make sure I'm clear on this. So if we have a gentleman comes in for an STD, we need to actually code his primary visit as family planning and STD as secondary?
Yes. And then that way, when you do check off those testing for, you know, GC, syphilis, chlamydia, whatever, then it'll get paid for through the family planning program. If you don't do that, then, you know, the STD program doesn't pay for those. So we will pay for them. And then also make sure you document that you ask them those reproductive life questions about, you know, do you want to have a baby? How are you preventing that? That type of thing.
So will the patient still have to pay a charge if the STD program picks up some of it?
Amy, this
like
is
a nominal.
Yeah, the nominal fee. No, the 802, it will pick up those codes and pay fee for service for those STD services that are provided for that as a family planning client. Now, if they just come in for STD services and they're coded to the 807, then that's when they would be charged the $5 nominal fee.
But you're going to get a lot.
Does that make sense?
Right. If you're not going to,
yeah.
If you're not going to, if you're not going to treat them as a family plan patient, but you'll get a whole lot more money back than $5 if you treat them as a family planning patient.
Yeah.
So you wouldn't charge them except a sliding fail. If they're uninsured and they slide between 100 and 250%, you would, you know, use that sliding scale guide. But we may need to have more conversations, but that's what we've been instructed about so far, about no nominal fee if you treat them as a family planning patient. Just use a sliding scale and treat them as family planning.
And then of course, you can let the STD program provide your antibiotics for that patient if they need them.
Right.
Okay, so just to be clear, what's requiring them for documentation to show that they were family planning?
Okay, documentation is by asking them the reproductive health questions. Let me get up here. So ask them about, you know, you need to ask them reproductive health questions and partner histories. So do you plan to have any more children? How many do you want to have? What are you doing to prevent that pregnancy? And is that working for you? Okay, and provide them that guidance. Okay, and then also, you know, then their partner history. And then and you document that just like you do your family planning patients, because they are a family planning patient, and then they are a family planning patient. Then they're just there for STDs. Because remember, these are the people who are family planning services. All these things are all considered family planning patients. Well, the related preventive services is an addition, but those top are.
Is there any way we can get those questions added to the
HCP
forms or the STD one?
They'll be added to ECW. So we're not going into the forms now, because within 6 months we'll all be on eClinical Works and on the electronic health record, but they will be on the electronic health record. So as soon as we got these all through the process, we wouldn't need that form anymore. So we're just using it we're doing it with ECW. You could document assess life plan or reproductive life plan, or, you know, just like you check that you did the partner history, you can also write in on your history, assess reproductive life plan, until we go to ECW.
This is Ann in Clark County. So in the past, we've always been told that whatever problem they present with this is always their primary. This has been drilled in my head for the 14 years I've been in clinic.
Mm-hmm.
So Medicaid is okay with this, and we're now going to start asking all of our STD patients' income and all that. Is that what you're telling me?
If you're going to treat them as a family planning patient, because that's true, the primary code is. But an STD patient is a family planning patient, and so we just never have recognized them as that in the past, okay? So STD patients, if they're of reproductive age and can have the ability to reproduce, I'm 55, or, you know, I'm postmenopausal, or I, you know, I've had about, you know, whatever, and if you assess that they can't have a baby, then they're not family planning patients, okay? If they're able to make a baby or to have a baby, and they're in for STD treatment only, then they are a family planning patient if they have the ability to reproduce. And that is a new change that we just haven't ever included them that way. You get better reimbursement for that. So, yeah, you have to, you know, you will have to assess them for their finances and stuff like that and not charge them the nominal fee. But you're going to get more money back for that. You know, you'll get better bang for your buck that way.
You may get more money back from Medicaid, but if you've got a private patient that comes in for STD treatment, and we typically charge them $5 service, and they have a $75,000 income, and you charge them as a family planning patient, I think it's very confusing for the nurses to try to decide, okay, are we considering these family players today, or are we not? They didn't come in asking for family planning. And I'm thinking of the males in particular.
Well, I think that that's going to be an internal decision for you. And when we look across the state and how many people, the number of people who come in making $75,000 and have private insurance are a very, very, very small amount of our clients across the state. So, you know, if that's a large amount of your clients, then you may reconsider if you want to consider them family planning patients. You know, my husband used to say that we don't do wallet biopsies when we take care of patients, but to make sure our clinics stay afloat, times have changed a little bit where we're still going to provide the same kind of care, but we're going to have to see which method will give us the best, you know, reimbursement for. So if you got a patient that comes in and he has private insurance, then you don't want to treat him as family. You know, you may not want to do that. You may want to just charge him the $5 nominal fee. And I know that's not going to work in that way, but I wonder how many patients you're talking about in that instance.
Anita, this is Glenda. I'm wondering about, on the slide you have that the CPT codes that are on that list are going to be reimbursed for Title 10 clients, which are the uninsured and no home contacts on the slide. So are these only for the uninsured and no home contact STD male patients that you'd be seeing?
That's who I'm going to reimburse with Title 10 funding, okay, is uninsured and no home contact. You can still do this with, what I'm saying is you don't have to change your procedures with Medicaid patients because they also follow the same guidance. They will accept that counseling code as your primary code because you're going to list the other ICD-10 codes with you. If a patient comes in for STD treatment, they're all the ones.
Thanks, Anita. Next, I'll ask Margaret Jones and her fine team. They all came in during our commercial break, and so we've got a room full of immunization program folks. So thank you, Margaret, for coming down today. And let me see, are we, Casey, can we try to fix this as far as, let me see here. Are we showing?
Do they have a PowerPoint?
No, they don't have a PowerPoint.
Okay.
I'm just trying to get,
yes.
I'm trying to get Margaret on the screen.
Yes, make my face up there.
I'm trying to get my face up there. Okay. Thank you. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
I'm trying, for sure. That's what I was trying to say. I was trying to get Margaret's face up there. No one likes the way to say that.
I'll help you.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you again, Margaret.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you for inviting us, Joy. Well, it's a pleasure to be here and to give you some updates in the immunization program. I'm Margaret Jones, Immunization Program Manager, and I've been around a long time. A lot of you may have known me as Margaret Stevens, but I've been Jones now for about 8 years. I want to welcome two new nurse consultants to the Immunization Program. We've added Debbie Donovan. She was formerly with the nurse consultant QI team who did site visits and audited all of the health departments. And then she went to family planning and the cancer program. She left thinking she wanted to go back to the local health department, and she spent the last year at a local health department actually providing services. We've talked her to coming in back to the state because now we have a nurse who has administered the vaccine and used our new registry in our program. So this has been a great asset. So she's working, her main focus is going to be adolescent vaccines and HPV. Some of you all may remember Debbie Donovan as Debbie Bridges from back in the cancer program years ago, but that's who that is. The other nurse that we're welcoming is Christy Royalty. She's returning. She is returning to her original spot in the Department of Public Health, the immunization program. She's worked there and she's worked with communicable diseases. She worked with the family planning program again, and she left public health thinking she liked the private sector better. We talked her into coming back to immunizations, back to doing vaccine preventable diseases, and her focus is going to be mainly childhood. So both nurses are available. We are now have six nurses in the immunization program. That includes Julie Miracle, Debbie Bolton Plunkett, and Troy Cunningham, and myself. So we are up and running. That's wonderful because we've been down nurses. I want to give you a few updates of what's going on in our program. The flu update. We currently have had 22 cases of flu reported in the state of Kentucky by our surveillance sites. So just to let you know that flu is out there, so be offering flu vaccine to everybody. Our Sanofi, or Sanofi, however you want to say it, 0.5 single dose prefilled syringes should start shipping in November. We don't know why they're not here. We don't know if it's something with the company, but we've been told they'll start shipping in November. This information was sent out on the listserv to all of the VFC primary coordinators, and it is also on the registry landing page to let you know about it there too. If you would like to have multi-dose vials, you don't want to wait for the 0.5 syringes. We have some. You just need to contact Ida Taylor at 502-564-4478. That's the number for the immunization program. Her extension is 4268. If you just call the immunization program and ask for Ida, and she'll help you to get the vials if you want those instead of waiting on the syringes. Adult vaccines. We currently have lots of adult vaccines available to local health departments. This vaccine is for un- and underinsured individuals, and it's all types of vaccines. Whatever you need for your adult population. If you are interested in this, if you want to do this, you want to hold a special clinic, contact Rita Lathrom. That's who you order your vaccines through, and she will put in an order and assist you with putting in an order for adult vaccines. Remember that Tdap vaccine should be offered to anyone regardless of their payer source. Kentucky is now considered to be in an outbreak status for pertussis. We've actually had 419 cases of pertussis this year. That's double what we had last year. So offer Tdap to everybody who comes in, especially to new parents and new grandparents to protect the newborn. School survey. The school survey 2016-2017 has been sent out. It can be completed all online, it's all electronic. Yay, finally, this is great news for our health departments and for our staff here. Our 2014-15 survey has been posted online at our website. It's available by county, so you can go and look and see what your county rate is for the school survey. It's even available by school site. So you can actually go and look at the schools where your children attend to see what their vaccination coverage is. The goal for this is for local health departments can actually use this as a QI tool to improve rates in their community and in their schools. Take this information, share it with your school sites, with your principals, your school boards, show them that what their rates are, and discuss the risk involved to the children who cannot receive vaccines, such as those with medical issues and on chemotherapy and that kind of thing. Kentucky is kind of bad on our adolescent, well, not kind of, we are low on our adolescent vaccine rates, so we really need to work on getting our adolescents and our children immunized. Recalibration of log tax. Am I going too fast? Okay. Recalibration of log tax. These are your digital data logging thermometers. Info was sent out on the listserv yesterday and will be put on the registry landing page again today or tomorrow. These are your thermometers that the immunization program bought for you to use in your units, your freezers and your refrigerators. The KIPP, or the immunization program, will cover the expense of having these thermometers recalibrated through the manufacturer, Control Solutions. After calibration, they will then be good for 2 years, so you'll have 2 more years of use of them. The guidance yesterday included a form that you complete with each thermometer when you send it back, with each data logger. When you complete it and wrap it all up and send it back. Don't forget that you must have a thermometer in your unit so you can, at all times, recording temperatures. So while you're sending your data loggers back, you can use your backup thermometer in your unit to take the temperatures, you know, and you may just want to send them one at a time, however, but they are aware, Control Solutions is aware, and will recognize the number on your data logger to know to bill us and not you. If you happen to receive a bill, let us know. If you have any questions about how to do this or what to do or anything about your data loggers, contact your field staff in your area. They're your first point of contact and they'll really help you to set up the data logger. Or you can call Erica Davis. She's here at the state in Frankfurt, and her number again is 502-564-4478. That's the immunization program number. Her extension is 4269. Now, next, we've got a lot of things going on in the immunization program. We have been really active and doing a lot of stuff. Our immunization conference that we're putting on with Kentucky Rural Health Association is scheduled for November 2nd, 3rd, and 4th in Lexington at the Embassy Suites. I know that the cost went up $50 on October the 15th, but if you are interested, you or any of your employees are interested, if you will send me an email, and that's Margaret C, the letter C, like in CAP, .Jones@ky.gov, I will work to get you in at the before the raise rate to save you a few bucks. This year, the conference is the fee includes all your meals. It's also going to include all your materials, and you will walk out with a bag of stuff that is worth more than the $100. So what you get out will be way more than what it cost. We had an excellent conference last year. We had such great reviews that we expect the same this year. This conference will be totally different. We will have different topics and a different focus. Our doctors, the presenters are all national presenters. We don't really have a lot of anybody from Kentucky except the immunization program. Dr. Darren Ferris is going to talk about the crisis in the healthcare failure to do primary HPV-related cancer prevention. And he has wonderful pictures to share. And I know nurses love pictures, so you'll love that. We're going to have a little vaccine storage and handling, about 30 minutes of that, and that will count as your annual storage and handling training if you attend. We're going to have exhibitors who will be offering giveaways and meeting with you. Dr. Omar is going to talk about adolescent vaccines and about meningococcal, Tdap, all the different ones. We're having an evening reception and the exhibitors are going to offer viewing of their products. Dr. Ari Brown is going to talk to us about how to talk to parents about vaccine concerns. And Dr. Ari Brown has been on the Today Show, the Morning Show, all the morning TV things. She is a contributing author to Parents Magazine. She's written the books Childhood 411, Infant 411, and if you're really lucky, you may get a 411 series on it. Trust me, you're going to get a book. Anyway, we're going to have Jody Schweitzer, our registry staff, and her staff are going to do a little Kentucky registry update and demo. We've got some new features on the registry, so she's going to talk about that you're going to really like. It's going to be great. Rebecca Back is going to talk about pertussis vaccine. She is a pediatrician who actually gave her child pertussis, her infant pertussis. So she's going to tell her experience and talk about why it's so important to give that Tdap to the pregnant woman. Dr. Brady's going to do pediatric vaccines. Thomas Irons is going to do adult immunizations. Raina Dubose is a surviving meningitis victim. She was a high school basketball player who was sought after by many colleges to be on their basketball team. So she's going to tell her personal story. She will make you cry and she will make you laugh. Dr. Ray Strikas from CDC is going to talk about vaccine updates and best practices. And Christine Vera is going to do Letting Science Lead the Way to Social Media Success. This last presentation is actually, we brought it in for immunizations, but it is actually using social media for anything. So whatever campaign you may be thinking about in the future, she is a great resource for telling you how to use social media. Again, we will be having, you'll have all your meals, breakfast, lunch, and dinner, and or breakfast and lunch for sure, and then the reception, and you'll get a lot of great giveaways. Now then, some reminders. One of the biggest reminders I want you to do is remember to tell your administrative folks, your front desk folks, your clerical staff to check for K-CHIP eligibility when they are doing income determination. Checking for the K-CHIP eligibility is checking for that P7 on the Medicaid page. We taught about this at our spring updates. We will do it again at our spring updates. If you have any question about how to find the P7, contact Laura Herron in the immunization program. You need to really, this is very important for a health department because this is the reimbursement for your K-CHIP administration. And with K-CHIP administration, you keep the entire amount of money. There is no payback like you do for the Medicaid side. So you want to make sure you check for K-CHIP. You keep more money, basically. It will help you financially, but it will also help the program to be able to account for the vaccine spent and to get reimbursement. We buy the vaccine, and Medicaid, K-CHIP reimburses us for the cost of the vaccine. So for us to get paid back, we need you to identify the Medicaid and the K-CHIP children. Another reminder is the last day to order vaccines for the holidays is November 18th at 12 noon Eastern Standard Time. Orders after this date will not be placed by CDC and McKesson. So we can't get any late orders in. So talk to your vaccine coordinators and make sure they have placed the order by November 18th and order enough to get you through until January, until your shipment can come in January. So they want to order about 2 months worth at least. Let's see. Also, all the MOUs for delegated authority for local health departments have been signed and they're in place, and they have been mailed back to the director so everybody can give the underinsured vaccines. Do you have any questions for me of anything I've said? I have one other person. Somebody have a question?
This is Paula from Estill County.
Uh-huh.
I missed the part where you said something about ordering by the 15th. What did you say?
Okay, that's your holiday order. You need to have your holiday order in by November 15th because CDC and McKesson will not accept any orders after November 15th. So you can't order again until January. So you want to order enough for like 2 months vaccine. That's basically it. This is a standard practice. It happens every year. It's nothing new, but we want to, and an information went out on the listserv about this last week, I believe. If they're not...
Louisville,
do you have a question?
Yes, this is Mary Louisville. The 22 cases of flu, what MMW are we going to start counting that for?
I'm sorry, I couldn't understand.
33.
Jody Schweitzer from the immunization program. She is the immunization registry manager, and she's going to give you a few little updates of things that are happening with the registry.
Hi, everyone. Again, I'm Jody Schweitzer, I'm the registry manager. Probably talked to you or met with you from time to time, but I just wanted to go over a couple things. When you logged into the registry yesterday morning, you probably noticed the things a little different. So we did get an upgrade to a new version on Tuesday night. The great exciting things about this new version is that the issues we were having with our immunization certificate on the state seal have been corrected. If you do see something that still isn't working right, please let me know at the help desk so we can get that on to the vendor and get it fixed. If you do need a provisional certificate, you still have to choose that off the list under the patient tab in the reports and training module. So in a later version, I think, and I'll certainly be letting everyone know, the computer itself will choose provisional or regular depending on the expiration date that comes up. But right now, you still have to know you need a provisional certificate. There is right now a bug that's going to be fixed in 2 weeks, or within 2 weeks, where if you have entered something, you can't delete it right now, but that will be fixed ASAP. Other good news is that the data we imported from the CDP, which was all the billed immunizations at each local health department back to 1996, all those duplicates have now been cleaned up in all the health departments. So you are welcome to start to use the reminder recall tool. You might just want to run a roster and clean up any patients that may not be yours anymore before you do a reminder recall list. All of those tools are in the reports and training module. There is a guide in the Kentucky Forms and Resources in that module that goes through how to run a reminder recall. You set up what you want to generate, and then it runs a job overnight, and when you come back in the morning, it's there, and it's just a list of everyone you had requested. So it works pretty nice. It's not too bad. The guide is just a little long, too, because it has a lot of screenshots in it, but it's actually a pretty nice walkthrough, so it's not hard to figure out. And there's also just a general guide that goes over the different reports. So all the reports are functioning that you see. So if there's anything that looks interesting to you, feel free to poke around. You're not going to break it if you run a report. It just may not be what you thought you were running. But there is a guide that goes over a brief description of all the reports. So if you're looking for some data, if you need a report back to your district or something, just take a look and see on that guide what you might need. Also, too, if you want, we can try to answer on the help desk. We're also trying to learn all the different reports as well, because there's just a lot of tools on there. All right, we also have two new modules. There's a school nurse module and a perinatal hepatitis B module. So those just came into the environment on Wednesday morning. The state staff involved in those projects will be configuring those modules and figuring out how they're going to roll them out and how they're going to use them. The school nurse module allows the school to create a roster underneath their school, and then that school nurse could access just their patients. And the perinatal hepatitis B module puts moms and babies together in a case and allows the babies to be managed for 2 years as the perinatal program does. Again, you're always welcome to ask us questions or ask for things that you need at the help desk. We're always there to help you. If you see anything you need, if you want something different, or if we just need to get you some different training, let us know and we're happy to help. Thank you.
Oh, I didn't ask for questions. You want me to ask for questions?
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
And I've got a question from the field for Margaret as well. Are there any questions for Jody before she leaves? And then I'll ask Margaret to come back up here. Any questions for Jody about the immunization registry? Okay. Margaret, the question is, that's like putting you on the spot,
yeah.
Is there? The two-dose HPV vaccine.
Okay.
Can you talk about that and the CDC
okay.
recommendations?
It just happened, and it has just cleared. We will be updating our protocol. It has to come out in.
It has to come out
on the
MMWR before we can actually update the protocol. But we are aware of it. As a matter of fact, I was reading about it this morning, and there is that they're going to have a webinar about it too with CDC. So we will be updating our protocol as soon as it comes out in the MMWR.
And that will be an emergency revision.
Yes, that will be an, that will be an emergency revision.
And who's been assigned to that?
And Debbie Donovan has been assigned to do that.
Okay.
So call us or email us. The best thing to do if you need any questions for immunizations, is email me, because I'm out of the office a lot, but I check my email quite frequently. So email me and be sure to put that C in the name or you get the bus driver.
I know, there's something with transportation.
Thanks, Margaret. So bottom line on the HPV vaccine, more information forthcoming. The CDC has to put that guidance in the MMWR that has to be published as all of the immunization, any changes do as well. And so then after that point, then the HPV protocol for the CCSG will be revised accordingly. And then that guidance would come out as an emergency revision to the CCSG. Thank you, Margaret, again. Yeah, you did have a lot of updates, didn't you? So thank you so much to you and your team for coming today. I just have a few closing remarks I wanted to share with you all. One, I wanted to remind everyone, if you haven't gotten your nursing license renewed, please be sure to do that. The deadline is October 31st. Please don't wait until the last minute in case there's any type of computer hiccups, either on your end or on KBN's end. Just we want to go ahead and make sure you've got all of that documentation in place. Also, if you're a nursing supervisor, please make sure that you follow up and make sure that you have all of your nursing staff's updated license in their personnel files. Remember, any nurses that you may have who are out on FMLA or maternity leave or out for whatever reason. In the past, those have been the circumstances where the nurses have, for whatever reason, forgotten to get their nursing license renewed. And so sometimes just a reminder helps get those on file like they need to be. If you do discover on November 1st, that you have a nurse who has not renewed her license, there is a formal process for that nurse to go through, and obviously he or she cannot practice as a nurse until her license is renewed. And if you need assistance with that process, please let me know. But I assure you that following up on the front end prior to October 31st and making sure everybody has their license renewed is a lot easier and less burdensome than what the paperwork is on November 1st. I did reach out to Robin Cotton from the Division of Laboratory Services. She was not able to join us today for the ITV, but she did send me a couple of notes that she wanted me to read for you all, or I'm going to read them and share with you what her updates were. She says that, Robin says, there's been an update to the Quintet AC blood glucose monitoring system by Consult Diagnostics. Robin has updated that standard operating procedure, the SOP, and she sent that to me. So I'll send that out right after the ITV so you all can have that for your records. She wanted to remind you all that the SOPs are living documents, and certainly if local health departments want or need to make minor changes for better clarity for their local health department, you are free to do so. So that was on the Quintet AC blood glucose monitoring system, new or revised SOP, and I'll send that out to you right after the ITV. Her second point is, if any local health department is aware of any updates or changes on any lab point of care testing equipment, please let me know and I will follow up with the local health departments as needed. The next point is, as a reminder, the state public health lab, DLS, does not need your monthly lab record searches. Continue to perform them and keep them for your local health department quality assurance program and administrative review. However, the DLS would like to continue to receive lab-related corrective actions and lab meeting minutes so we can be informed on the local health department's lab's progress and be aware of any issues or concerns to better help serve them as needed. So I'll send these bullet points out with the SOP that Robin sent to me this morning, and so you'll have this information on hand and reference. And if you have any questions, please feel free to contact Robin at Cotton at DLS. Wanted to just recognize and mention for you all who may not realize that ECW trainings were initiated this Monday for four pilot sites. Those four pilot sites include Bourbon, Madison, Lincoln Counties, and Green River District Health Department. So the rollout for those four pilot sites will be October 31st, that first week in November. And then that pilot period will last until about mid-February, when the program and the ECW process will be evaluated and reviewed as far as the implementation piece. And so then the determinations about next steps and the rollout for the other local health departments will take place at that time. So I wanted to thank those four local health departments and thank everyone who has served from other local health departments as well on the systems build teams. And we've been working on that for about, on ECW for about a year and a half. And so it's great to see it come to fruition and see the trainings getting ready to happen and those pilot sites getting ready to go up. I wanted to mention that the NEC, the Nurse Executive Committee meeting, will meet next Tuesday. One of the items on our agenda is to review and hopefully finalize an agenda for the new nurse leader orientation. I hope to have those dates set within the next couple of days. I'm looking at early November, and so I want to go ahead and if all possible, have that training before Christmas, because we have had so many new nurse leaders. And it may be that you know, if you all feel like you're not able to make those times, if December's getting too busy for you all already, I can look at dates in January, but I'm always concerned at that point about weather. But I do know that we have many new nurse leaders, and there's lots of information that we want to be able to share with you all, have subject matter experts come from here in the department and other sister agencies that we have that can help discuss with you and share with you all and provide technical assistance to better be able to do your job and feel comfortable and competent for the new nurse leaders, as a new nurse leader in the local health department. The last announcement I wanted to share with you all is I sent out the announcement about the Breast Cancer Trust Fund grant applications. The RFP was sent out earlier this week. The deadline for submitting those applications is Friday, December 2nd at the close of business. They must be postmarked by December 2nd. The grant amount awards are can be funded up to $20,000, and they fund, those dollars fund breast cancer education, outreach, awareness, screening services in local communities to address the morbidity and reduce mortality of breast cancer in your local area. So if you haven't applied for Breast Cancer Trust Fund fundings before, please consider to do so. We always love to have new grantees on hand. If you have applied for funds before and you're a previous grantee, we'd love to have you back. And the funds for those grants are supported by the sale of the pink license plates, as you may know, Driving for a Cure, and the state income tax checkout box. It has the Breast Cancer Trust Fund box on there. So that's all I have for today. It's been a crazy ITV with all of our technology, but I thank Education Workforce Development for all of your help. We brought in new TV screens and everything else, so I do apologize for any inconvenience. We will be looking and reviewing this presentation for through GoToMeetings, and that might end up being with our technology hiccups, that might be the way for us to go in the future. So thank you for everything that you all do. Holler at me, call me, or email me if you have any questions or comments or concerns about public health nursing or programs here, and I'll be glad to assist. The next ITV will be held December 15th, and so that's in about 2 months, so we'll see you then, if not earlier. Take care. Bye-bye.